Welcome to your first experiment with StatE's DOE software. In this video, we'll go over how to identify the right design for your needs and set it up in StatE's 360 or Design Expert software. To demonstrate the different steps, we will be testing changes to a cake recipe. This video is going to use a number of terms that aren't going to be explained fully. If you want to learn more about a given topic, check the description. We've linked several helpful webinars that go into more detail about different kinds of designs, design evaluation, and more. DOE can be defined as a series of tests in which intentional changes are made to input factors to study how they affect outputs we are measuring. We use DOE when we want something to be different about our product or process. So, the first step to designing your experiment is to identify your opportunity. What about your system do you want to change? With our example cake, we want to study how certain variables affect the taste and texture, two identifiable properties of the finished product. Then, we'll define our objective. How do we want the taste and texture to change? Let's say we want the cake to feel more moist than it was before, and we want it to taste sweeter, but not too sweet. Now that we know what we want to change and how we want it to be different, we'll select the factors or components to test. In an experiment where we just want to change the texture, we might pick out a few process factors, like the amount of time spent mixing the batter, the temperature of the oven, and the baking time. A basic two-level factorial design could suffice for this type of experiment. We would pick two levels, length of time and degrees of temperature, to test. Then set up this factorial design with the design picker. Always make sure your factor levels are reasonable. For example, the baking time and temperature should be set such that we end up with cake. Testing temperatures of 0 and 700 degrees Fahrenheit is unlikely to produce any meaningful response data, just raw batter or cake-shaped charcoal. Likewise, the levels must also be reasonably far apart. Testing the cakes at temperatures of 350 and 351 degrees Fahrenheit is unlikely to produce a meaningful change. If we decided to test more levels of each factor, that can be done with a multi-level categoric design or response surface design. Factorial designs are great for systems where you expect the interaction between your factors to be linear, and when you are largely interested in the difference between two factor settings. But what if you think there's curvature in your system? For example, if we think the best cake lies somewhere in the middle of the design space and the edges will be worse. That's when you try a response surface design. These design types add points in the middle and edges of the design space, as well as replicates to your design, allowing you to model a wider variety of behavior. If you aren't sure what kind of response surface design to use, optimal or custom designs are a good starting point. With this option, you just enter your factors and levels and the software figures out what kind of design is best. Factorial and response surface designs are great for process factors, but what about the cake batter itself? That's a formulation, a system where the proportions of components drive the response, not the actual quantity of ingredients. Doubling all ingredients is not likely to change anything about the cake, except the quantity produced. If I want to adjust my cake batter, I will be changing the proportions of the ingredients, or components, of my batter formulation. This means we need to use a mixture design. While some mixtures are simple, like mixing up lemonade, most industrial formulations, and my cake, are more complex, and you'll want to use the optimal design option for mixtures. If one of your factors or components is extremely hard to change, for example, if you need to shut down and cool off your oven between each temperature change, you can use a split plot design to account for it. Only use split plots if you have to, though. A fully randomized design is almost always better for your budget. You may have noticed the screening options for both factorial and mixture designs. These are used in situations where you may have dozens of potential factors and can't reasonably perform a full experiment with all of them. A screening design helps you narrow down which factors or components should be studied more closely. We have other videos about screening designs, so we'll skip to the next step in our cake-making design journey, quantifying the objective. how much change is a significant change in your system? It's not worth the time and effort to experiment on a cake if it's going to basically taste the same afterwards. It needs to taste significantly sweeter and feel significantly more moist if I'm going to adopt a new recipe. I'll measure sweetness on a tasting scale of 1, not sweet or sickly sweet, to 9, perfection, and moist mouthfeel on a scale from 1, sand or water, to 5, perfection. In order to determine if the cake is different enough, I need to decide on signal and noise values for my experiment. The signal is the detectable change. I want to improve my taste by at least 2 rating points, and my texture by at least 1. Anything below that will not be noticed by a typical customer. The noise is how much variation is present in the system. You can base your noise off of historical data, run some experiments using the current settings, or estimate it using noise data from a similar process. I'll estimate that my taste noise is 1 rating point, and that my texture noise is 0.5 point. Now it's time to evaluate my design. If I'm using a factorial design, that means I'm looking at the power of my design. A good guideline is to have power of 80% or more for your main factors. That means the given design can detect active effects about 80% of the time if they are actually active. If a factor is not active, the design may still produce false positives, known as the alpha risk. The default alpha risk we almost always use is 0.05 or 5%. For response surface designs and mixture designs, we want to look at precision instead. Use the FDS graph to determine whether the design will meet your needs. A score of 80% or higher tends to be enough. While we can use DOE to reduce costs, remember that there's always a trade-off. If you pick a design that's not powerful or precise enough in order to save time or money, you might end up with an experiment that doesn't have a good chance of producing conclusive results. One last note about baking a cake, or working with any process where you're combining design types. The final taste and texture of my cake might depend not just on the cake batter, but the filling and frosting as well. It's important to test all the parts of my system together in order to get the most accurate results. We hope this helps you get started with your first DOE. Again, check the description for more in-depth explanations of the design types and terms used in this video, and let us know if you have a design you want us to review. Happy experimenting!